Good morning. I'm Keith Poston. I'm the president of WakeEd Partnership. Welcome to our first ever Capital Coffee Talk. We've done a lot of things different, just like all of you have over the last year, and a lot more virtual events. And I felt like this would be a good opportunity at the beginning of the year to talk to some of our Wake delegation. We have both some returning members to the General Assembly as well as some newly elected members. So we reached out and invited them, and I'm going to introduce them in a moment. But this may become an annual event, but I think for this year, for sure, we're going to do more than one of these because there are some opportunities. I mean, you think about the Capitol, we are focused on Wake County Public Schools, but being the largest school district, everything that happens here in the Capitol, whether it's the governor's office, the legislature, state board, state superintendent, I think they all have a big impact. Y'all know how the way our schools are, the governance is structured. There's a lot of power here in the Capitol. And so we're going to do some more conversations later this year. But I do want to thank all of you for joining us. I do want to thank our sponsors. We appreciate everyone who supports WakeEd Partnership, but for this particular event and series, SteelFab, Salido.net, and Sarah Quinlan helped us make this first one possible. So thank you to our sponsors for that. Let's get started. I want to first thank our legislators and introduce them, those who are joining us. I'm going to start with our newest member of the Wake delegation, Sarah Crawford. Senator Crawford was just elected. Congratulations to you. Sarah represents District 18, which is both Wake County and I think believe part of Franklin County. So Senator Crawford, welcome and thank you for being here. Staying in the upper chamber, we'll go to Jay Chaudhuri. Senator Chaudhuri has now served, you're at three terms now, Jay? Or this is the beginning of your fourth?
It's technically my third. But not full two terms. And then,
okay. Yeah, I know some of you guys come in different times, with the fill vacancies, but Senator Jay Chaudhuri, thank you for being here. On my screen, to my right, Representative Julie Von Haefen, Representative Von Haefen, two terms in the House and represents District 36. Julie, welcome this morning. Thanks for being here. Representative Cynthia Ball, three terms also, District 49. Cynthia, welcome this morning. And last but not least, I will say the most veteran member of our Wake County delegation, the incomparable Rosa Gill. Always good to see you, Representative Gill. Always glad to have your voice, especially as we've worked together for a few years on things. And as a teacher, former teacher and educator, it's always great to have your voice. So let's get started. What I'm going to do is I want to direct my first question to our longest serving and our shortest serving, Sarah Crawford and Rosa Gill. We'll start with you. So we're just going to jump right in. Representative Gill, now we're not really in recovery from COVID-19 yet. I mean, we're still in the middle of it here in Wake County. Wake County Public Schools, about 50% of our students are in virtual full time. And of those that are on, are doing some kind of rotation, there's still an ever changing in-person virtual. In fact, our high school students have yet to have a single day, I believe, at this point in person here in Wake County. So what can the General Assembly do, beyond what, some of the early investments you made, what can the General Assembly do to assist Wake County Public Schools and really all of our schools across the state to sort of meet our students' needs now and also when we do get to what we'll start seeing as a recovery?
Good morning, Keith, and thank you for inviting me. And it's nice to be with all of the educational experts. I just call myself just one of the legislators who happen to be interested in education. One of the things that we're going to have to do is increase funding. And I know we always talk about increasing funding, but we're going to have to do it both ways. We're going to have to do it hopefully on the federal level and on the state level. Now, we've got to remember that if we get state funds, we cannot supplant. If we get federal funds, we cannot supplant our current state funds. And that's one thing that I am going to be looking at very carefully, because I know sometimes when we get federal funds, federal dollars, we always think, let's spend it, and then we spend it on non-recurring items, and then we look the next year at what we do not have and what we need. So increased funding is going to be one of our main things that we're going to have to do. And I hope we can, because I think this summer or during the pandemic, most of our kids, quite a few of our kids, especially our underachievers, lost learning. And we're going to have to find out how we can best help them with learning loss. And one of the things I'm going to suggest, and I don't know the other members, we have not talked about it, but we're going to need additional help in the classroom. Most of our kids are doing virtual learning, and it looks like we're going to be doing virtual learning for quite a while. So we're going to need some assistance in the second and third grade to help our students with virtual learning and to help the teachers. Another thing we're going to have to do is use our federal dollars to increase broadband and other technology resources that we need. I think the governor is talking about a bond, a school bond, in order to help school LEAs build schools that are needed. We're going to have to look at schools differently. We're not going to have that little box room with 30 chairs in it and the teacher standing in front of the classroom. So we're going to have to learn how to teach differently. I think our kids can learn. They just have to be motivated. And I think our teachers are learning how to motivate them. At the same time, they're motivating themselves to be more innovative. So right now, the two things that I want to see is reduce or help get assistance for lost learning, increase that, increase access to broadband, make sure we have the correct enough funding so that we can help our schools where it's needed, and our additional teacher's assistants, or a couple of them. I'm trying not to name everything because I know the other members of the legislature have their ideas and want to put their input into it. So right now, I'll stop and let some of the others go.
Senator Crawford, Representative Gill, I'm checking off all the questions I was going to ask about things we might need. So I'm not surprised that she hit a lot of them, because there are a lot of needs, right? I was glad to hear you mention staffing, because I hear so much from, you know, when we talk to Wake County Public Schools, you know, as far as getting back in the classroom safely, a big challenge. I think some of you may or may not know this, is that it's not necessarily what's happening with transmission inside the buildings, but just the teachers themselves, and they have someone in their family gets exposed or someone is sick, and then all of a sudden they're out, and we've just had this ripple effect and teachers are already wearing a lot of hats before a pandemic. So Senator Crawford, what would you add or expand on of what Representative Gill had to say?
Thank you, Keith, so much for having us today. I'm so honored and humbled to be in this virtual room with so many great education experts. And can I just say ditto to everything Representative Gill said? Representative Gill, you hit so many of the points. I think, in addition to increasing funding and ensuring that we have the staffing that all of our schools need, I'm one of those parents. I have a child who's on a rotation schedule, and I have another child who is in virtual academy. So, we're fortunate that our children have everything they need. They have broadband, they have access to technology, they have a parent who can be at home with them. But so many of our children do not have that. And our teachers are working so, so hard. So, you know, in the short term, we really need to make sure that we're making those shorter term investments in broadband to ensure that everybody has access to the internet reliable internet that they can get access to that technology. And I know that Wake County's done just a great job doing that, but I'm sure that our school board members would say that they need more resources for that. So, you know, adding to those, Representative Gill mentioned this gap in the learning loss. And I think, you know, we're still learning a lot about what that learning loss is, you know, and what it means to be so many months or so many weeks behind. You know, I think one of the things that I am most concerned about is for those children who, you know, we know that there's data that says that there are some groups of children who are you know, who are experiencing greater loss or have are impacted in a more negative way by this virtual learning that they've been doing, either because they are in families where the parents can't stay home with them, they don't have access to technology, you know, they don't have what they need. And so one of the things that we're going to have to make sure we do as we recover is to ensure that we're putting resources appropriately into those communities for those children who have been most negatively impacted by the pandemic and by not being in the classroom, so that we can make sure that we don't have those achievement gaps. We don't want to widen those achievement gaps. You know, we're always working to close those achievement gaps. So we're going to have to make sure we allocate resources appropriately. The other thing I'll say is that, you know, before we can really return to the classroom, we need to make sure that every teacher in the state who wants to get the vaccine is able to get the vaccine. And I know that, you know, there have been significant challenges around folks getting the vaccine. And trust me, everybody here on this call is working on that, particularly for Wake County. You know, but that's one thing we need to make sure that everybody can return safely.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I had the idea of vaccines. I know I reached out to the governor's office yesterday. I was just sort of asking sort of where things were in terms of the status. And I mean, look, I have a lot of confidence of what I've seen with the governor's office and Secretary Cohen. But at the same time, this is a national and international issue, and there are supply chain and issues going up. But I would love to see the legislature get creative into what can we do, you know, to when those supplies are there, we've been shut down for now, we're coming close to a year. If we can shut down for a couple of days and get everybody vaccinated, I mean, I think a lot of teachers would feel a lot safer to go back into the schools. Julie von Haefen, I want to go to you next, but I did forget to mention something at the beginning, and I just wanted to touch on we invited several legislators, and we actually, those of you who are here in Wake County, and some of you are not, all of our legislators and delegation are Democrats except one. We actually had Erin Perret, who was elected in November. Did talk to Erin. She could not be here this morning, but she will participate in a future thing. She had a conflict, but we did invite Erin as well as Abe Jones, who had a schedule conflict, and not really a new legislator, but new to the Senate, Sydney Batch. I talked to her, and she was unable to be on. She is in court today. But anyway, I did want to mention that we had some other legislators. I know Joe John's on the call too, but we appreciate all of you. And I just wanted to mention that. Julie von Haefen, I think when I first met you, you were real involved in leadership with the local PTA. And so I've always thought you had a good sort of sense of where things are. What are you hearing? What are you feeling as far as what you can do as an individual legislator and collectively to support our families and support our schools getting back to normal?
Yeah, thanks, Keith. I think when we first met, I was on Education Matters as the Wake County PTA president talking about class size chaos. And Here I am, you know, I think about 4 years later, serving in the legislature. So it's my honor to be here. I think parents, you know, are frustrated, of course. I hear a lot from constituents about how can we get our kids back into the classroom? And I have three kids in Wake County Public Schools, so I completely understand what they're going through. But I think parents have to understand that, well, one, the legislature doesn't really have anything to do with getting kids back into the classroom. That's a decision from DPI, the governor, and our local school districts. And Wake County Public Schools has done a fantastic job in a really, really, really difficult situation. I said during the election, I said, I don't know who would want to run for school board right now, because all they're getting is grief and, you know, complaining. So whoever's serving on the school board, I know Christine Kushner's on the call and I see Jim Martin. Thank you so much for what you do, because it is just, it's a thankless job right now. But I think, you know, that, you know, some kids are doing okay on virtual learning. I don't want to always perpetuate this, you know, this narrative that every kid is failing, that every kid is doing a, you know, horrible job and we're all learning, you know, we're all going to have this huge learning loss. Yes, that's definitely true for some kids, but I want to highlight the fact that some kids are thriving in this environment and that teachers are doing a fantastic job of, you know, thinking outside of the box, thinking creatively about how to engage kids. And so, you know, I just want to make sure that we're not giving the impression that every kid is failing, you know. And so I just think that, you know, we need to keep engaging our parents and making sure that they feel heard in this situation. And every time somebody, you know, sends me an email, I always try to commiserate and say, you know, I'm in the exact same position and we're working as hard as we can. And like you said, Keith, you know, getting teachers vaccinated is of course a number one priority of the state. And I just wanted to make sure, if you guys didn't know, you all live here in Wake County, I believe, that we had a fantastic program with Wake County on Friday night. And it's on the WRAL website where they talked about the vaccine rollout here in Wake County. And right now there's over 180,000 people in groups 1 and 2, and we're getting no vaccine doses. And it's not the fault of getting the doses out, it's that we don't have them. And so it's really from the federal government down that there's a backlog. And I just want to say that the state has reassured me that putting teachers into group 3, the reason they did that is because their number one priority after getting those 65 and older and our healthcare workers vaccinated is getting kids back in the classroom in person. I know that is a priority of the state. And so they're working as hard as they can to get there.
I appreciate it. Yes, that's exactly what I hear too, but you're right. But that is frustrating that we are, in some ways we've done, some things have happened quickly in the last couple of months, but here we are, the vaccines are, and we see these news stories where it's X million have been released, but only a certain number have gone into arms and what's going on with that. I think we all hear anecdotes and rumors that there's like extra doses being thrown out. I'm sure that does happen, but I don't think that's really the problem that we're dealing with. I want to make sure I get everybody to weigh in on the COVID. So Jay Chaudhuri, I want to go to you. One thing I was curious about, Representative Gill mentioned learning loss, and how concerned are you about the learning loss? You know, when we were really getting into the teeth of this at the end of last year, which we thought we were, and it kind of spiked up bad again, I remember seeing something probably on Twitter. It said something like, our kids aren't falling behind, they're surviving a pandemic. And sort of like, what is sort of the reality of where we are, and sort of what do you think we, the legislature can do to think creatively about helping school systems?
Yeah, but thanks, Keith, and as everyone else mentioned, really thrilled and honored to be with you on this morning's discussion. I think to answer your question, I think there is consensus across the board that we have to do something with learning loss. I mean, I think if you listen to conversations both with Republican leadership, with our new incoming Department of Public Instruction superintendent, they will all agree that we have to focus on learning loss. I mean, I think that the question really becomes, how do we measure that learning loss, and then how do we address the learning losses? And there are tools that are available. I mean, some of it, I think, will push the General Assembly in a direction that it's been reluctant to do so. I mean, one issue that comes to mind is an ongoing issue for a lot of school boards, and that is calendar flexibility, because a lot of these districts may want to have the flexibility that they need in trying to tailor and carve out a program that's unique to their school district. One could argue that those districts ought to have some kind of individual and unique responses in addressing learning losses. I think that the other issues that will converge, I think, with the General Assembly, you know, as I think about it, are the recommendations that came out of the consultant that looked at the recommendations for Leandro. There's a lot of focus on multiple areas for education, whether it's the need for early childhood education, which we know is a real challenge for us, and the loss to the economy. There's a recommendation for almost $35 million to go in early to address early childhood education. We also know that there's going to be a real focus with this General Assembly looking at K through three literacy rates and some of the programs that frankly have not been successful, and what we can do in addressing those. And then, you know, as I think about Wake County specifically, I mean, I think that both Representative Von Haefen and Senator Crawford are absolutely right. I mean, I think getting our teachers vaccinated has to be one of the top priorities for the state. And we see in Davie County, I read recently, has actually started vaccinating teachers. But then secondly, you know, if the vaccinations are not implemented in a timely manner, the question becomes what kind of personal protective equipment may we, you know, do we have if that even comes into use? If the school board continues to go the virtual route, then that may not be important, but that certainly then addresses the other question that becomes an issue that's become a recurring theme this morning, and that's looking at broadband access. I mean, that is a long-term solution. I'm not sure that there is a short-term solution to that, but I think if anything, Keith, the pandemic has laid bare the real inequalities that we have in education, and I think is a reminder that we have a lot more work to do than maybe some folks even expected before we entered into this pandemic.
Yeah, and I think that's we've had a couple of comments, questions on the chat, and about this issue of broadband. And I know that there are. And it's one of the things I think, you know, we know there are statewide issues, and sort of one thing I hope that we can dispel. I mean, I live here in Wake County. We're very fortunate. We're very blessed in a lot of ways that we have the kind of tax base and support to fund our schools the way we do. We fund our schools better than most across the state. But that doesn't mean that there aren't a large swaths of poverty. There is joblessness. There are communities that were hit harder than other communities here in Wake County from this pandemic. And there's been comments on the chat about the broadband, and we'll have to get back to that, because I do think that there are issues right here in Wake County. You know, there are issues around cost. You can have devices but not have what anyone would consider high-speed internet anymore, you know, and to be able to work. You know, again, all of us have experienced the pandemic, but we have not all experienced the same way. And there are families that are struggling in ways that others who are on many of us who are on this call did not struggle, did not lose their job, did not lose insurance, did not lose their home. And so let me wrap up the COVID part of this COVID conversation with you, Cynthia Ball. You're in touch with your constituents. You've been here. You know what's going on with the schools. What are your thoughts about some immediate things that can be done? I need to unmute you. Unmute. There we go.
Thank you, Keith, again to everyone for the chance to be here with you. And given that I come in last to the great colleagues that have come before me in making comments, there's not a lot that I can add other than to maybe reemphasize some things that have been said and maybe add a couple of others. I see that our Superintendent Moore is on the call, and she just brought up something that I think is extremely important to remember, that the Wake County school programs have done a great job reaching out into some of our communities that have access to broadband issues. As Keith mentioned, they don't have the right devices and so forth. I do hope that what we will push for in the coming session is whatever relief funds are available, we will fight for them for our schools. We need them. Our teachers, I've always referred to them as being our frontline workers. We talk about essential workers. To my mind, they and our staff members, our bus drivers and others in our schools are on the front lines, and they do need the vaccines as soon as we can get them. I know there's some creative solutions being presented here in Wake County that I hope maybe we can pursue. And someone also mentioned the issue of suicides over in the chat. I don't have any data, but I'd certainly be happy to reach back out to the person who asked that question. If there is data about suicides, we have kids. I remember when I was first elected, I primarily was most concerned about our public schools. So I went in my district and visited all the schools in the district. And that was years ago before the pandemic. And just when I was in one of the schools one day, an 11-year-old boy was threatening suicide there in school. So we've had a problem with kids having mental health issues. So right now, one of the things I hope we will do, we talked about a lot, is to put more school psychologists, nurses, and other mental health related professionals that can keep a watch on what's going on with our kids. Child abuse, we don't have, kids are not in school right now. So we need to make sure we're taking care of them while they are at home. And so I know that the school has ways, teachers, that we have such wonderful heroes who are teaching our kids virtually in the virtual academy or online. And I know that they are looking out for and reaching out, literally reaching out into the families if they see anything that worries them about the engagement of those students and the mental or physical health of those students. We have great challenges, and I'll continue, as I have been in the past, to fight for our public schools. They're at the top of my list. So thank you for having us a chance here to talk with everyone about these critical issues at this time.
Great. Well, thank you, Cynthia Ball. I'm not surprised you guys brought up so many important issues. And I'm not sure who said it at the very beginning, but it was probably Representative Gill. All these things cost. I mean, these all take investment and resources. And, a couple of things come to mind. We are, this is a long session, which, historically would be a time for a new 2-year budget. Well, a lot changed in Washington, D.C. in the election. We have a new Democratic president. We now have a Senate that is, split 50-50, but with a Democratic leadership. But here in North Carolina, the power structure and sort of the makeup of the way our state is led really didn't change very much. We still have a Democrat as governor. We have Republicans leading the legislature with a majority. And what that part of that dynamic led to is we've had no state budget that was actually approved and passed and supported the last couple of years that have sort of rippled effect through the school. So I guess I would ask you a question about that, and then I want to get sort of slide into the discussion about the Leandro work, because again, a lot of that has to do with resources. But I'll get back to you, Jay. Let's on the Senate side, sort of, are you optimistic? Are there, an unprecedented crisis sometimes can bring about unprecedented cooperation, or it can make things worse. And what do you think?
Well, I think with a new session and with the elections behind us, I think for the most part, those of us on the call, I think hold some optimism in passing a budget. And while I recognize that we were not able to do that, last session, certainly there was bipartisan cooperation in the allocation of the COVID relief dollars that we were allocated as a state. And so I hope that we can address some of these issues, but I think it's also around managing expectations. Let's be clear. There are differences in how the parties approach providing support for public educators. And just as an example, there was a difference in the number of dollars that was allocated for personal protective equipment that was proposed by Democrats versus Republicans. And there was also a $20 million gap on the mental health school services that were provided, an issue that Representative Ball just highlighted. So I hope that maybe through this pandemic, that there's been some lessons learned, that each legislator and a lawmaker actually comes to realize how difficult it is to teach, because I think every parent, including myself, now has just a bit of a glimpse of how difficult the teaching profession is. And hopefully that'll drive a little bit more bipartisanship and cooperation.
Yeah, I do worry, and I saw there's some, guys, keep the chat going too. There's some great conversation and questions. We're doing our best here on the WICAT partnership side to keep up with some if I need to flag it. But a lot of conversation about teachers. Representative Gill, I'm going to go to you on this one. We've been focused and we've been talking about teacher recruitment and retention for several years. I think some of that focus did lead to some much overdue and needed increases in teacher pay, but some other things didn't happen. We also saw the restoration of a teaching fellows program. But I guess you know, I know the turnover has come down a little bit last year, but I also think there's some real concern that a lot of teachers right now are just holding on because it's income. I mean, no one's going to voluntarily leave a job in the middle of a pandemic, but when this is over, at some point, or, you know, that we're going to be dealing with that. What can we do, Representative Gill, to improve the retention and recruitment of our teachers, given, frankly, what they're dealing with here? And it's not a thankless job when it comes to this crowd, but it is definitely a hard job. So what do you think?
Well, I know for a fact that our teachers are going to need some help, and that only the help that we can best give them is individuals who can help them carry out their responsibility as far as educating the child. I thought about the fact that we need we need trained teacher's assistants, those who can go in and do the job of a teacher. And in order to have trained teacher's assistants, we're gonna have to provide professional development for those that we hire. I think we might have a shortage in teachers, because there are teachers who are afraid of the pandemic and they may not return. So in addition to replacing those teachers, we're going to need additional teachers. And I do know for a fact that there are quite a few teacher assistants or individuals or parents who would love to be teacher's assistants to help out in the classroom. So we may need to look at how we can recruit a support staff for the teachers. And we need to be able to pay them. We need to make sure that we can give all of our support staff a minimum wage. That's one thing that I'm hoping that we can do also. We're gonna have to learn to teach a different way. I know the traditional teaching method where we sit in the classroom and we lecture to teachers. Students do not learn that way now. There's a whole new way of learning. So teachers are gonna have to learn to teach students where they are and move them forward. But you know what, I agree with Jay. I think there is a new awakening in the General Assembly to the needs of our students. They are our future, and we've got to provide for them. So I think that we might see that is one topic that we will agree on. And I'm hoping that they will help us move education forward.
Yeah. Senator Crawford, you campaigned on teacher support. And I'd love to get your thoughts, and Julie, maybe some from you, about sort of what else we can be thinking about and doing for our teachers, whether it's pay or, again, I don't want to lose the thread. I mean, Kathy Moore, I think she, or no, it was Christine, dittoed it on the chat. That there is some real staffing challenges right now in the schools when they are in the building. You all know what it's like, and they can't go somewhere if they've got to, and they're trying to check temperatures and get and social distance and do all those things. But Sarah, what's on your top list?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I just, you know, I want to echo what's already been said from Senator Chaudhuri and Representative Gill, you know, that I am hopeful that there is a new awakening about what is needed in our schools. At the same time, as Senator Chaudhuri said, I think we have to really set expectations. A couple of things that have been mentioned in the chat already that I just want to raise in case folks missed it. We need to bring back master's pay for teachers. That is something that we have to do. And we need to increase pay for all school personnel, not just our teachers, so all the support staff. And we need to make sure that we're recruiting, as folks mentioned, the supports for those teachers, so that teachers can focus on teaching and not focus on on those other parts of checking temperatures and, you know, monitoring the PPE and all of that kind of stuff. So, you know, we need to put resources to that. And as has been mentioned before, federal dollars that come in can't supplant what the state was going to do. And the state needs to do their job so that the county can allocate their resources appropriately and don't have to make up for what the state isn't doing. You know, so I think, you know, I am really interested in tackling this issue. As you mentioned, Keith, it's something that I did campaign on. My mom's a retired educator, and I don't know that she, I'm not sure that she would have made it through this pandemic, you know, just given where she was towards the end of her career and how difficult and challenging it already was outside of a pandemic. So, you know, we need to be looking at all of those things. We also need to be looking at the retirement benefits for teachers. So we know that those have changed effective this year.
I'm glad you brought that up. I had that on my list because I don't know if people, I doubt anyone on this call or most of them forgot, but our teachers lost retiree medical benefits 3 years ago, and that bill comes due this year. So starting this year, if you're hired as a teacher, you will not be eligible for retiree medical benefits. You know, in the middle of a global pandemic, this is what we're sort of where we are with teachers.
Absolutely. And we're already not paying our teachers enough. And those retirement benefits for a lot of folks can be an incentive to come and do the job and stay with the job. And we've eliminated that incentive. So, you know, I think we really need to look at those things and how to bring retirement benefits back.
Julie, what about master's pay, retiree medical? Had any conversations at the General Assembly that there might be some movement on either?
Well, the retirement medical benefits was a bill actually I filed last session, and I plan on refiling it again this year. I will say that, you know, the one conversation that I think Republicans have over and over again, and is that I think they're finally seeing that the teacher pipeline in North Carolina is a major problem. I mean, you can't doubt the data where it shows, you know, all of our teacher programs across the state just declining in enrollment. And it's getting worse because of COVID. And I know that there's been more retirements because of COVID, you know, even though they lost, you know, those retirement benefits, but this is gonna be a major problem in the next 10 to 20 years in North Carolina if we don't address it right now. And I think that I hope to see some movement around that. I mean, I all the things you mentioned, master's pay and benefits, and, you know, we can't keep, there has been talk about changing, you know, teacher salaries for pay for performance, which is a terrible idea. I mean, again, we're putting, you know, this huge burden on teachers, giving them all these tests, and, you know, they have to live up to these certain, you know, data points. And it's just, why would anyone want to go into teaching at this point? They have so much on their plate. And it's just, we've got to change the way that we look at education, or else we're going to have a major problem for the next decade in North Carolina.
Right. Well, that's a good segue into a couple of things I wanted to ask y'all about. We can go back to Representative Ball and Senator Chaudhuri for this. I think Jay mentioned Leandro. You know, we know from research that from an equity perspective, the student outcomes track almost perfectly with poverty. And I mentioned that Wake County is not immune to that. It also, which then in turn, because it's poverty, it tracks with race. And so, I mean, it's true all across the state. And then at the same time, you know, when this pandemic, we were just getting to a point, this is a unprecedented crisis, but we've been living through, in my opinion, I think Wake Head Partnership's view, that a 25-year crisis where we have not adequately funded our public education in the state, our constitutional obligation to provide a sound basic education for all students is, and then so we sort of got to a point where there was an action plan, there was some discussion that was like, okay, all these things were all lining up, and then, you know, the world turned upside down. So Jay, let me ask you first, I mean, do you think that, I mean, I know things are not going to be the same. I mean, nothing's going to be the same from this point forward, but how can we not lose the thread, if you will, on ensuring that this promise of sound basic education is there, the investments, because all the things we just talked about, I mean, look at the action plan, look at the things, it's pretty simple, a great teacher, a great school leader, an adequate resource. I mean, it's not, it's not complicated, but it's expensive and it takes commitment. What do you think? Where do we go from here?
I mean, Keith, I think it's a great question. I think it really, so look, I mean, I think there are probably two arguments around the need to invest in education as we look at the budget. One is one may be focused on kind of austerity and maintaining the rainy day fund. The other is frankly about long-term investment. And I think if anything, as I mentioned earlier, the pandemic has laid bare the fact that we have not done enough to invest in public education. I would also say that we need to double down on investing in public education, given the fact that we face real challenges. We face mental health challenges with our kids. We face workforce development to try to get children that, you know, seniors that may not go into college or may go into community college, to get them back in the workforce. We face challenges to try to get to rebuild our middle class. I mean, all of those things, frankly, require investing in public education. And so from my perspective, this is not the time to really debate austerity measures or trying to, protect the rainy day fund. I mean, if anything, we've just experienced a Category 5 hurricane as far as public education is concerned. And we need to do everything that we can to invest in our children so we have that long-term return, which is frankly putting our kids into good paying jobs. I mean, ultimately, let's not forget about the link between education and economic development. That's the long-term goal that we're all seeking.
Cynthia, you got some thoughts on, I know you've done some work around some of the Leandro consent orders and action plans. What do you think about where we go starting this session? Is it something we can do in the middle of this recovery?
Well, I certainly hope so, Keith. I think we cannot stand back and say that because we have a crisis of the pandemic that we didn't already for years have a crisis in public education as far as underfunding and not respecting our professionals that are teaching our children, and they are our workforce for the future, and they are our future. So I intend to continue working on things like teacher recruitment and retention. I filed several bills in the last session. I will continue to file them to try to build our teacher pipeline. Even though I know we're in a crisis now, we have to remember that we plant seeds for today, what we're going to reap tomorrow. So we cannot avoid trying to make sure that we help those kids who are in our high schools, middle schools even, be interested in becoming teachers and start there, and also work all the way through until we restore master's pay and medical benefits and so forth. Why would anybody want to come into a classroom, no matter how committed they are to public education, and work in a situation when they've lost their benefits? They are heroes. I've said that many times. I have heard from some people who seem to have their finger on the pulse of some of the leadership. There is interest around putting more mental health and school psychologist type of professionals in our schools. And that's one good thing I hear. And I know, of course, our Leandro order mandated, it is constitutional. Let's remember that. It's a constitutional thing that we are to provide a sound basic education to our kids. And that includes taking care of our teachers and making sure that our kids are learning. And I want to emphasize several things. I'm having a hard time following the chat. You all are great asking questions. I mean, I bring it up and one of my colleagues already answers it. So if I sound like I'm being redundant to what's already been said, let's just say I'm emphasizing it. Our special needs kids have not gotten the attention that they need, even more so during this pandemic. So there are many other things that I believe we can do. We just have to stand firm. I like the term that Senator Chaudhuri used. We need to double down. We need not to back off and say that we can't do this, because we can. We do have a rainy day fund. We do have more tax resources than I think we thought we were going to have. So there is nothing in my mind more important than taking care of our public education in North Carolina. And that means in our public schools. It does not mean increasing a lot of funding for opportunity scholarships and others. I know that there are people who disagree with me about that, but that is something that is, when we are starving our public schools by doing huge tax cuts and also allocating resources that we do have into our private schools that are not accountable to in many of the ways that our public schools are. And we just need to continue fighting for that.
Does anyone want to add something? I don't want to lose anyone on our panel, because I do want to bring up a couple of things, and then I wanted to give a chance for people to ask a couple of questions. But one thing that I think has been encouraging the last several years, you mentioned, I think there is a greater understanding around mental health and social emotional learning and those important supports. So I was hope we can build on that. The other thing is early childhood. I mean, I think that we over the last, I don't know, several years, 5-7 years, we've finally gotten past the debate that it doesn't work, or that it doesn't help, or that it goes away. I feel like, but even though that debate is theoretically past us, it doesn't always match up with the dollars. And you know, we've seen, I think Rosa Gill mentioned supplanting. We've seen that happen, where monies that we thought were going to be helpful for early childhood didn't. Representative von Haefen, early childhood has been something you've worked on. I'd love to get your thoughts, and Representative Gill, if you've got some thoughts on early childhood. And let's hear it.
Yeah, I mean, I think somebody mentioned before, early childhood is a big part of Leandro, so that does kind of nicely segue into this conversation. You know, we have a major child care problem and an early childhood problem in our country, and this COVID has really, of course, another thing that's really highlighted. And it really goes down to the structure of early childhood education in our state and in our country, and the fact that our child care workers and early education teachers are not paid nearly enough. They're not paid living wage. They're not given medical insurance. So many of our early education teachers fall into the Medicaid gap that we talk a lot about, that coverage gap that we're trying to fill by expanding Medicaid. They don't make enough, you know, to buy it on their own, but they make too much to get it right now. And so I hear so many anecdotal stories about child care workers and early education teachers who don't get the medical treatment that they need for conditions, and people suffer. And that is just unacceptable, especially now that we know that early education is so important for our children. And so we have to treat early education teachers just like our K-12 teachers. I don't know why we aren't doing that right now. We've got to rethink how we're doing that in our state. And I think also we need right now, we need to increase the subsidies for childcare in North Carolina. They're not nearly enough. We have way too many kids on the waiting list. I mean, I could go on and on. There's so many things that we need to reform, but honestly, right now with COVID, we need to make sure that those childcare centers and early education centers are staying open, because right now they're losing enrollment. And the teachers don't have any way to take time off if they're sick or a family member is sick. And so they're really struggling just to stay open. We already have a childcare desert all across our state. And if we lose these centers and they keep closing, we're gonna be in for a real world of hurt, because women especially are not gonna be able to go back to work, because as we know, most childcare falls on women. Women have suffered the brunt of COVID more than men, honestly. And so we've got to make sure that they stay open by giving bonus payments to our childcare workers, hazard pay. We need to make sure that they have the PPE and all the things that we've mentioned so they can stay open. And then we need to work on longer term fixes for our childcare and early education system to make sure that they thrive in the future.
Well, this is a good place to speak truth, Julie. So thank you for bringing this in. Representative Gill, do you wanted to add anything about sort of family supports, early childhood?
Well, I agree with Julie 100%. The only thing I can say is that I know for a fact that early childhood education is great for the social and emotional well-being of our students. So the earlier our students can get in and become socially and emotionally involved in the educational setting, the better off they're gonna be in life. So I agree that we need to pay them more. We need to make sure that we have a structure in place that will ensure that they are ready for learning when they get to the K-3. And I agree, we gotta keep our childcare programs available to those who need it most. Most of our individuals who live in poverty will not be able to afford childcare. Unless we make it free, we're going to have to put quite a bit of resources into helping those who need it most. So I will be looking at how we can ensure that our underachievers and that our poverty areas have childcare available to all who need it. And again, we can look at the parents. If the parents saying that they cannot afford it, maybe we can give them some professional development so that they can help in the classroom. There are many ways that we can help, and I'm sure we're going to be looking at all of them.
All right, very good. All right, I want to try to get some questions in. I have to comment. I just love seeing this. Although it's heartwarming, but also sad. I see these teachers who have been joining the call that are saying, "Sorry, I've got to go. I've got to go join my class." And so, thank y'all, educators who came on and are here, and for people who work for the system. I would take a couple of questions from the audience, but I do so. If you want to give me a wave, and I'll see if I can call on you. But I did see one from my friend Tom Oxholm, who I thought raised a good point. You know, Wake Ed Partnership is backed by business, and so are a lot of other education groups. But yet we have one of the lowest corporate tax rates in the area. There are resources that might be available. So I guess the question for our legislator, Cynthia, raising her hand, maybe she can say something about the idea of, can we do more? Is there any appetite in the legislature to look at revenues and where, well, let's face it. I mean, some companies really took it hard during the recession, but others have done quite well. So what do you think?
Well, I think we need to think creatively about responding to Tom Oxholm's question. Yes, we need the business community to stand up and say that their futures and the economy of the future depends on the public education of our early education all through high school and into technical training and the university system. We need to make a priority, and we need our business community. You're the ones that are on the front line talking to both sides of the aisle, as the saying goes, and we need you to reinforce that we need to find a tax system that is fair, that taxes the revenues of those that are making huge benefits, and some of them even more during this pandemic. We certainly don't want to further cripple any businesses that have suffered so much, but we can find a way to raise revenues at this time from those that can most afford it. And I hope we will work to do that. And I ask the business leadership to help us do it.
Julie, Jay, anyone else want to add in on that? Julie?
I was just going to say, I mean, right now, we might not even need to raise revenue. I don't know if you all know, but we have $4 billion sitting in our bank account right now that is not earmarked for any purpose. It's just sitting there. And that's over and above the $1 billion we already have in our rainy day fund. We have the money that we could use to invest in a lot of these things. And a lot of the things that we've mentioned today won't even cost anything, or they will cost a very minimal amount when you look at the big picture of our revenues in our state. So we have the money right now. Yeah,
$1 billion in rainy day and $4 billion in excess revenue right
exactly
today.
Yes.
Okay.
And so we need to get the business community to contact your legislators and say, for example, if my comments on early education really struck with you and you say, my workers can't come back to my business if they don't have childcare, right? And so you need to contact, you know, the leadership of the General Assembly and say, we need supports for early education and childcare right now because I need my employees to get back to work when they're ready. And so please help us support that industry, for example. So we need your voices because a lot of times they'll listen to you more than anybody else. And so we really need you to talk about how that money could be invested in education.
I have one question that's a good one I saw. So what can people who are parents, we have a number of parents all on the call, but sort of what can parents and the public do to have an impact? You mentioned calling your legislators. How does that, I mean, and it's another one of those weird things where it's not like people are walking the halls of the legislature the way they used to be. Jay or Sarah Crawford, any thoughts on the best way to have your voice heard?
Well, Keith, I would say that parents can still advocate with members of the General Assembly. Unfortunately, it is difficult and, you know, perhaps almost close to impossible to do those in person. I mean, I think that each legislator kind of decides what kind of rules they want to apply in doing in-person meetings, and those often are the most effective ways to advocate for public education, but you can certainly still make phone calls and send emails as well. And so I think it's critically important, has been highlighted by other members here, to do that. Keith, I just wanted to say one other thing to kind of build on what Representative Von Haefen said, and you know, on early childhood education. I mean, again, just linking the notion of education to our economy. I mean, we know that because we don't provide enough early childhood education and care, that that's a loss of $2.4 billion to our state's economy. That number has actually increased by another $500 million because of the pandemic. So again, you know, I think we should, when we're talking about education, we should not be talking about in costs, but investments, and in some instances about savings. And so I think it's just an important point to, important fact to point out.
I want to highlight something, and then Sarah, I want to hear from you as we're getting close on time. Julie, of course, she's still touting the PTA, but I mean, there are my friend Susan Books on. Susan is talking about the other organizations that are out there, Every Child NC, the Education Justice Alliance, Save Our Schools, your local PTA, the Public School Forum, Wake Education Partnership. You know, we are all part of the choir, and you can join a choir that will help amplify your voice. You know, we're all in this together, man. You know, this is kind of what we, I think this is a way for us to find. And I can tell you, in my previous role at the forum, that class size issue, which was such a challenge, and it's not over, but we're obviously not dealing with it. That changed because of parents, and that changed when there were parents walking along the carpool lines, handing out paper at elementary schools here in Wake County. That's why that changed. It wasn't any of us, you know, smarty pants groups. It was parents, you know, who did a lot of good work. So there is a way to do that. Sarah, you know, do you want to add something?
Yeah, I'll just add to that. I think Senator Chaudhuri is exactly right about tying this to the economy. You know, we know that education, particularly public education, is where we deliver on the promise of equality. It's the number one predictor of social and economic mobility. And so, you know, tying all of those things together, I think, is going to be really important. I would also encourage, in addition to what's already been said about joining a choir, emailing, calling your representatives. You all have a lot of friends of public education here in Wake County. Find friends and colleagues who can email and call their legislators from other districts outside of Wake County, where, you know, where we might not have as many friends of public education, and make sure that those folks, those legislators, senators and representatives hear from folks in their district. You know, it's a lot more compelling to hear from your constituent than it is to hear from, you know, someone who's a county over that's not your constituent. So make sure that it's the constituents who are reaching out directly to their reps, and find those friends outside of Wake County.
And that's what I mean. Look, again, not those who don't do this for a living or work on policy issues with education. You have to understand the money comes from the state. I mean, it's the state's constitutional responsibility to provide funding for our schools. And if we were doing it the way it was designed, it would only be the buildings at our local counties. But we know that's not the way it really works here in Wake County. Literally hundreds of teaching positions and TAs and principals and assistant principals are actually paid for by local dollars. But you're absolutely right. The money is at the General Assembly. And so that's where, you know, that's why we wanted to have this coffee chat this morning. We wanted to sort of remind you that we need folks volunteering and working and supporting locally in their schools, but we also need you to keep an eye on, you know, the decisions that happen at the General Assembly that directly affect the quality of the education of your kids' class. We are bumping up against the time, and I want to respect everyone. This just flew by. It's so great to see. Again, so I got to say hey to Dudley Flood again. It's always good to see Dr. Flood. And again, so many good friends here on the call. We appreciate all of your engagement. Wake Education Partnership board members and supporters who are on the call, and our legislators. We are going to go back through our chat, and if there are things that we missed, we'll try to reach out. And I know all of our legislators. Some of them put their, you can find them on the website and they will be happy to. Sarah just put her, how to find her, how to, Twitter, Facebook, they're all very active and involved and engaged. And I can tell you that they are all very responsive. So, please let them know what's on your mind because, things are really just starting now at the legislature. Really kind of, I think you, Julie and Cynthia, I think you guys are just getting sort of committees set up and things are starting to cook, but this will be the time when, the governor hasn't released his budget yet. The General Assembly will come up with its budget. So there will be opportunities at Wakehead Partnership. If you're not on our mailing list, go to wakehead.org and get on that, because we'll definitely highlight where things that are going to flow through both at the state level, as well as our county commissioners and school board, and where things are going to affect our schools. So I appreciate that. But with that, I just want to thank you. We're going to wrap up again. I want to thank our sponsors, Solido, Steel Fab, for helping us with this, and Sarah Quinlan for helping us with this event. Keep an eye out for your email and on social media for a future coffee chat. It's been great. We really appreciate your time this morning, and we look forward to seeing you all soon. Take care now.